Here we are, but straying pilgrims here. Our path is often dim, but to cheer us on our journey still, we sing this wayside hymn. Yonder over the rolling river, where the shining mansions rise, soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes. Here our feet are often weary on the hills that throng our way. Here the tempest darkly gathers, but our hearts within us say, yonder over the rolling river where the shining mansions rise, soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes.
Hello and welcome back. Thank you so much for joining me here today to worship our God. You know, it's such a wonderful blessing to know that you're watching these, to know that you're going into your God's Word and looking up Scripture and taking time to worship our great and glorious God. Thank you so much for doing that. Thank you for being here. We're going to have the same worship service we always have. We'll have a couple of songs of praise to our God. We'll have a song to get us thinking about the Lord's Supper. We'll partake of the Lord's Supper, then we'll have another song of praise. We'll have our lesson, and then as usual, at the end of this video, my scriptures will scroll up. I encourage you, please, get your Bible out, read it, and see if that's not what your Bible says. The only thing I'm trying to do here is to bring glory to my God and to edify you, and above all, give you what the Word of God says. Not what somebody says it says, but to give it to you for what it says. Thank you again for being here. To begin our worship service this morning, would you bow with me? Father, again, we, your children, have gathered here together on this your day to worship your God. We thank you so very much for this opportunity. We thank you for your word. We ask, Father, that you bless us in this worship service, as it is our desire to do those things that please you, our God. We thank you for being our God. We thank you for all the blessings you bestowed so richly upon us. We ask, Father, that you be with all of those that we've prayed for, that you care for them as they have need and as you will. For ourselves, Father, we ask your forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, thanks so much for joining me here today. We'll begin our worship service now.
Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, from the heavens praise his name. Praise Jehovah in the highest, all his angels praise proclaim. All his hosts together praise him, sun and moon and stars on high. Praise him, O ye heaven of heavens, and ye floods above the skies. Let them praises give Jehovah, for his name alone is high. And his glory is exalted, far above the earth and sky. Let them praises give Jehovah, they were made at his command. Then forever he established, his decree shall ever stand. From the earth, O praise Jehovah, all ye floods, ye dragons all, fire and hail and snow and vapor, stormy winds that hear him call. Let them praises give Jehovah, for his name alone is high. And his glory is exalted, far above the earth and sky. All ye fruitful trees and cedars, all ye hills and mountains high, creeping things and beasts and cattle, birds that in the heavens fly,
kings of earth and all ye people, princes, great earth's judges all. Praise his name, young men and maidens, aged men and children small. Let them praises give Jehovah, for his name alone is high. And his glory is exalted, and his glory is exalted, and his glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's fight, old war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own.
and the joy we share as we tarry there. None other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his all. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling. But he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Before we partake of the Lord's Supper this morning, I'll be reading to you a passage that I've read to you before to get us thinking about Jesus the Christ. I'll be in the second chapter of Paul's letter to the Colossians. I'll begin at the 11th verse of the second chapter. In him you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he is made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Primarily, brothers and sisters and friends, Jesus Christ went to the cross to finish what needed to be finished, to end the old and to bring in the new, to sacrifice himself for his creation, so that we, after obeying the gospel, might be forever forgiven by our great and glorious God. Jesus Christ, before he was hung on that cross, knew what was coming. And as they celebrated the Passover feast, he took a moment to ask his disciples and us to remember him, and to do that by partaking of this ceremonial supper. He set forth the bread as a representation of his body, and he set forth the fruit of the vine as a representation of his precious blood. And he asked us to partake them. And as we did, remember him and what he did for us. That's what we're doing here now. That's what we're doing with these implements. I'm going to ask the blessing for the implements. I'm going to ask that while you partake of these implements, that you pause this video, that you stop. Just take a few moments and consider what our great God did for us, that we might be with him forever and forever forgiven of our sins. Would you bow with me now as I ask the blessing for the bread and the fruit of the vine? Father, we come before you at this time in thanksgiving. We thank you so very much for this opportunity to remember Jesus the Christ. We thank you for these implements, this bread, the representation of his body, and this fruit of the vine, the representation of his precious blood. We ask you to bless these and to bless us as we partake. And allow us, Father, reflection on what it took to save your creation from itself. Thank you so much, Father, for that great sacrifice, for these implements, and for the opportunity to remember Jesus the Christ. It's in his precious name that we pray. Amen.
Jesus, Rose of Sharon, bloom within my heart. Beauties of thy truth and holiness impart, that where'er I go, my life may shed abroad of the knowledge of the love of God.
Jesus,
blessed Jesus,
Rose of Sharon,
bloom in radiance and in love within my heart. Jesus, Rose of Sharon, sweeter far to see than the fairest flowers of earth could ever be. Fill my life completely, adding more each day of thy grace. Divine and purity, I pray.
Jesus,
blessed Jesus, Rose of Sharon, bloom in radiance and in love within my heart. Jesus, Rose of Sharon, balm for every ill. May thy tender mercy's healing power distill for afflicted souls of weary burdened men. Health and hope again.
Jesus,
blessed Jesus, Rose of Sharon, bloom in radiance and in love within my heart. Jesus, Rose of Sharon, bloom forever. Glory seen on earth from shore to shore, till the nations own thy sovereignty complete. Lay their honors down and worship at thy feet. Blessed Jesus, Rose of Sharon, bloom in radiance and in love within my heart. Savior,
lead me lest I stray,
lead me lest I stray.
Gently lead me all the
lead
way,
me all the way.
I am safe when by thy side
I will
Lord, in thy love abide.
Lead me, Savior, lead me, lest I stray. Gently down the stream of time, lead me, Savior, all the way.
Thou the refuge of my soul,
when life's stormy billows roll,
I am safe when thou art nigh,
all my hopes on thee rely.
Lead me, Savior, lest I stray.
Gently down the stream of time,
lead me, Savior, all the way.
Our readings today, again, will be coming from both the Old and the New Testament. Today we're going to begin in the book of Exodus in the 14th chapter. And we're going to read verse 13 of that chapter. And Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall see again no more forever." Then over to the prophet Isaiah. In that book, we're going to be in the 52nd chapter. And I'll be reading to you the 7th verse of that chapter. "How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, 'Your God reigns.'" Then to the Gospels. In Luke, the very first chapter of that Gospel, I'll begin reading there at the 26th verse and following. "Now in the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, 'Rejoice highly, favored one, for the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women.' But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus.'" Then in that same gospel, over to the 19th chapter, and we're going to be reading there verses 1 through 10. "Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacharias. I'm sorry. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass by that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, 'Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house.' So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when they saw it, they all complained, saying, 'He has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner.' Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, 'Lord, look, I give half of my goods to the poor. And if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore it fourfold.' And Jesus said to him, 'Today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham.'" Then over to the next gospel, John. Very familiar passage, because I read this one, because you can't bend the truth, can you? First chapter of John, verses 1 through 4. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. In the same gospel, the third chapter. Now, I know you've heard 3:16 a lot, but we're going to read 17 today. Chapter 3, verse 17. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Then over to Luke's accounting of the Acts of the Apostles. We're going to begin there in the fourth chapter of that book, verse 10 and following. Let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by Him this man stands here before you whole. This is the stone which was rejected by the builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. The eighth chapter of Acts, and we're going to be reading quite an accounting here, so hang on. We'll begin in verse 26 of the eighth chapter. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, Arise and go towards the south, along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert. So he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge over all her treasury, had come to Jerusalem to worship. He was returning and sitting in his chariot. He was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, Go near and overtake this chariot. So Philip ran to him, heard him reading the prophet Isaiah, and said, Do you understand what you're reading? And he said, How can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. The place in the scripture where he read was this, He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation, for his life is taken from the earth? So the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or some other man? And Philip opened his mouth and, beginning at this scripture, preached Jesus to him. Now they went down the road, and then they came to some water. And the eunuch said, See, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized? Then Philip said, If you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. Now when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Then the 22nd chapter, same book, Acts. One verse in the 22nd chapter. Let's see, you know, that doesn't do justice to it, so we'll start at the 12th chapter of verse 22, or 22nd chapter, verse 12. Then a certain Ananias, a devout man, according to the law, having a good testimony with all the Jews who dwelt there, came to me, and he stood and said to me, Brother Saul, receive your sight. And at that same hour I looked up at him. Then he said, The God of our fathers has chosen you, that you should know His will, and see the Just One, and hear the voice of His mouth. For you will be His witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. And now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized, and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Over to Paul's letter to the church in Rome. I'm going to start there in the 6th chapter, beginning at verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Well, certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Therefore we were buried with Him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in a newness of life. For if we've been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. And now, chapter 10. And we're going to begin there at verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to the knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law, the man who does those things shall live by them. But the righteousness of faith speaks in this way, do not say in your heart, who will ascend to heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who will descend to the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is in your mouth. The word is near, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame, for there is neither no distinction between Jew or Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But then how shall they call on him who they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him who they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now, let's go to 2 Corinthians. And I will read to you from the 6th chapter of that letter, and I will begin at verse 1, and I'll read verses 1 and 2. We then, as workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain, for he says, in an acceptable time, I have heard you, and in the day of salvation, I have helped you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Yeshua. Salvation. The English pronunciation of Yeshua is Jesus. Salvation was granted throughout the scriptures to God's people. Salvation is something that is here written in God's word. The gospel of Jesus Christ, and obeying that gospel. One of those scriptures that I read to you, Romans chapter 10, has been sorely brutalized and pulled out and used to negate all the rest of the chapter, all the rest of the letter. One or two verses in Romans chapter 10 have been used to say all you need to do is believe. Well, brothers and sisters, if you believe Jesus the Christ, if you believe the gospel, then you want to obey the gospel. I read you the story about the Ethiopian and Philip. And once he understood and believed who Jesus was, obviously he was being preached to by Philip how to obey the gospel. Otherwise, he wouldn't have asked, here's water, what keeps me from being baptized? He wouldn't have asked that question if Philip hadn't mentioned it. Paul, who wrote Romans, gave his own story, his own confession. When Ananias came and healed his blindness after he saw Jesus on the road to Damascus. And Ananias asked Paul, "What are you waiting for? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sin." Now you're going to hear people say, "Well, he's just one of those water dogs. He's just one of those people that say, you have to be baptized to be saved." And that's not what Romans chapter 10 says. Romans chapter 10 says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. All you have to do is call on his name. What does the Bible say? Yes, it says call on his name while being baptized, washing away your sins. Yes, it says call on the name of the Lord and you'll be saved. That was part of Paul's preaching the gospel. You must believe after you hear. You must repent of the old life because you're about to kill the old man and bury him. And you don't bury him by saying, "Be ye buried." You bury him by putting him under. You baptize into Christ Jesus' death to replicate the death of the sinful man. To be raised up, to be forgiven of your sins forever. There's a lot of people out there that don't believe what I read. They feel that their professors and their pastors and their men of much learning can find how the Bible says that all you need to do is call on the name of the Lord. Fine. I do not debate Scripture. I do not debate the Bible. What I tell you is read it. See what it says. If your Bible says what I read to you out of my Bible, then my question is this. When Jesus said that all authority was given to him in heaven and on earth, what right does anybody have to take that authority and change it? To take what he said and change it? If you can show me who has the authority to change what he said, if you can show me an example in the New Testament when Christ rose from the dead and ascended to heaven, following that, show me some place in the Bible where it says he called on the name of the Lord and he was saved. I don't believe you can. But again, I'm not going to debate it with you. I'm not going to argue with you. I'm going to tell you this. What my Bible says is, hear, believe, repent, and obey. Obedience is baptism. That's what my Bible says. Thank you so much for being here with me today. God bless you. Please read your Bible. Please look these scriptures up and read them for yourself. I don't ever want it said that I said something that you believe. No, I read you the Bible. Go and read yours. God bless you all. Thank you for being here. To close out this service, let's go to our God in prayer. Father, we thank you so very much for this opportunity to read your word. We thank you for giving us the gospel of Jesus Christ, allowing us the understanding to see what your gospel says and giving us the choice whether to obey it or not. We ask, Father, a blessing upon all those who have not obeyed the gospel, that you will reach down with your mighty hand, steer them down the narrow path that leads to Yeshua's salvation. It's in that precious name, Father, that we pray. Amen. Thank you all again so much for being here. God bless you for joining us today for this worship service. As always, go out into the world this week and be a bright and shining light. You belong to God. You should be happy all the time. God bless you all. Have a wonderful week.
All things are ready. Come to the feast. Come, for the table now is spread. Ye famishing, ye weary, come, and thou shalt be richly fed. Hear the invitation, whosoever will.
Come,
hear the invitation, whosoever will. Praise God for full salvation, whosoever will. For whosoever will. All things are ready. Come to the feast. Come, for the door is open wide. A place of honor is reserved for you at the Master's side. Hear the invitation, whosoever will.
Come,
hear the invitation, whosoever will. Praise God for full salvation, whosoever will. For whosoever will. All things are ready. Come to the feast. Come while he waits to welcome thee. Delay not while this day is thine. Tomorrow may never be. Hear the invitation, whosoever will.
Come,
hear the invitation, whosoever will. Praise God for full salvation, whosoever will. For whosoever will. All things are ready. Come to the feast. Leave every care and worldly strife. Come feast upon the love of God and drink everlasting life. Hear the invitation, whosoever will. Praise God for full salvation, whosoever will. For whosoever will.
Be with me, Lord, I cannot live without thee. I dare not try to take one step alone. I cannot bear the loads of life unaided. I need thy strength to lean myself upon. Be with me, Lord, and then if dangers threaten, if storms of trial burst above my head, if flashing seas leap everywhere about me, they cannot harm.